Everything you can that had helped the human being was salt on the cross. So all the darkness, all the iniquities, all the sinfulness of human beings were applied on his body as a call on the cross. That was why there was darkness for 4 hours. You know, he was that scapegoat. Remember, he told the people that as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, that people looked onto it and was healed, the same thing he will happen to him. He was that serpent. He was that cross. Because the Bible says, cursed is he that hangeth on the tree. He received every imaginable curse of humanity on his body. Yet he did not commit a single sin. You see? See what he did for you and I? See, now when I say that you and I owe the debt, we can never repay. That's why there was darkness for 3 hours. Satan was given free rein to attack our Lord Jesus. I don't just think it was the agony, you know? No, no, no. On his body, there were all kinds of cancers, all kinds of madness, all kinds of imaginable problem was put upon him. He was afflicted with it. Whilst he hung on that cross for 3 good hours, from 12 p.m. to 3 p.m., Satan was given free rein to exact vengeance. Perhaps Satan was thinking that he would quit. That when I really, you know, afflict him, he will say, no, I've had enough. I'm coming off the cross. This is too much, Father. Perhaps that's why that happened. But Jesus never quit. If he never quit on you then, why do you have to quit on him today? Why do you have to refuse him today when he has done all this for you? Remember, he did it for the whole humanity. Everybody is able to access Jesus, is able to come to him and receive that free gift of salvation. He said, come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and come with me. For I gentle and humble, and you find rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is nice. What are you still waiting for? What are you still waiting for? There's no time to waste. You don't know what happens tomorrow. So he hung on that cross for 3 hours. Then he paid. Let's go to the book of Amos 8, verse 9. Book of Amos 8, verse 9. And Mark 15, 33. Mark 15, 33 says, when the 6th hour was come, there was darkness going to go out until the 9th hour. Amos 8, verse 9.
And it shall come to pass in
the day,
says the Lord God, that I will make the sun go down at night, and I will darken the earth in broad daylight.
See? So that prophecy was fulfilled. That pointed to the time was going to spend on the cross. And he fulfilled that prophecy. As Jesus himself said, I came to fulfill the law, not to abolish it. See? And about the 9th hour, Jesus cried out with that voice saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? This was at the peak of his sufferings. In fact, this is probably the only time, well, probably the 2nd time, the 1st time that Jesus referred to his Father as my God. He never did. The only other time when he resurrected and told Mary that he went to your God and my God. Before then, he only referred to him as my Father. You see? So at the point, the greatest point of his pain and his suffering, this language is Aramaic. This is the language that Jesus spoke. Well, it was not Greek. It was not Greek. It was not a Jewish language. It was Aramaic. It was a mixture of the Jewish language and another language. Now this is the language they used in that film, The Passion of the Christ. It said, my God, Why hast thou forsaken me? This was actually seen back in David in Psalm 22 verse 1. And Hebrews 5 verse 7. Why did he say that? Because he felt that God had forsaken him. Why? Because God is a holy God and God cannot look on sin. And at that time, Jesus was made sin for us. He carried our sins on his body, and God cannot associate with sin, because God is a holy God. You see, that's why he felt there was a separation from him and his Father. That's why he fashioned as my God. In other words, I'm being judged. That's why you're forsaking me. So let's go to Hebrews 5, 7 and Psalm 22, verse 1. I'll go to Hebrews. Book of Hebrews, chapter 5, verse 7. Hebrews, go to Psalm 22, verse 1. Are you in Hebrews already? Okay. Yes. Yes.
With fervent prayers and tears to him who was able to save him from death.
Yes.
And was hurt because of their weak faith.
That's it. See? He cried out to his Father, and his Father heard him. Do you think it was easy for God the Father to look on his Son suffering on the cross like that, knowing that he was completely innocent? He said, the God that did not spare his Son for us, how much more will he give us anything that he wants? It was not easy for God the Father to turn his eyes away from the sufferings of his Son. Normally, he would call upon his Father, and immediately the Father would help him. Remember, they came to arrest him. He said, don't you feel like I sent for 12,000 angels to come and rescue me? But on this occasion, the Father could not be seen. He felt that separation. He felt the distance. So he said, my God, my God, what hast thou forsaken me? See? He felt forsaken. If you ever felt forsaken, remember our Lord Jesus Christ, that he too felt the same thing. Now, God had not forsaken him. The only reason he felt like that was because he had made sin, and God could not relate to sin. That's why he felt forsaken. But God was there all the time, watching him. Just like God is watching you wherever you are. He said, I will never leave you, nor forsake you. See? So God will not forsake you even though you felt forsaken. No, he's there with you. But you have only been allowed to go through that experience so that you can develop your faith and your walk with him. Never ever imagine that God will forsake you. No. God did not forsake you, he just felt it because of so much pain and agony he was going through. Remember he prayed, let him get sick, and he said, if it's possible to take this cup, and do it. If not, let your will be done. And this we see the humanity of our Lord Jesus Christ. Once they come on the cross, you see the human side of him coming out. So those that stood by, they thought it was calling for Elijah, and went and filled his sponge with vinegar. This is the second time. Put on a reed and give him to drink. The rest said, let us see whether Elijah will come and see him. So, of course, these were Roman soldiers who had absolutely no faith in God. They were all idolaters, idol worshippers. They probably thought Jesus was just this Jewish fool who had been killed for his foolishness. They didn't care a hoot what happened to Jesus. They wouldn't care less. As far as I know, it was just another criminal. They've crucified so many criminals. It's just another one. That's what they thought. And I can't blame them for that because they didn't know any better. Now Jesus prayed to God, said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. See? And today God is still forgiving us. As you crucify my flesh, He forgives us as we come. So the rest said, let us see whether Elijah will come and save him. Jesus, then when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. You see, death did not kill Jesus. Death killed those who have sinned. And Jesus did not have any sin. So even if I remain up for 100 days, he would not have died, whatever they did to him. Death would not claim him. He himself yielded up the ghosts. In other words, he gave up his spirit to God. In another one, another gospel said, it is finished, and he yielded up the ghost. Cried with a loud voice. See? So we can see that it was as if he died out of physical ailment. No. He was still strong enough to give a loud voice saying, it is done. How did he know that it was done? Because Satan had thrown everything at him, and there was nothing else for him to face again. And he knew that, yes, he had done the work of salvation. He had paid for every imaginable sin. He had taken every punishment that every crime could demand. Give up the ghost. He gave his spirit back to God. He willingly did it. Death did not kill our Lord Jesus Christ. See, very important to know that. Some people think that, only human beings like you and I can die because we are sinful. But somebody who is like Jesus, who is sinless, death could not claim them. See? Now, when he died, what happened? So Jesus, and behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from the top to the bottom, and the earthquake quick, and the rocks rent. So it was a big earthquake. The veil of the temple is the veil, the curtain that separated the holy place from the Holy of Holies. There was a curtain there. So when Jesus died, his spirit left his body. There was a release of power, confirming that he was the Son of God. The power was so much that there was a big earthquake. The earthquake and the curtain was torn. Now, the tearing of that curtain pointed to the breaking of his body on the cross. That veil was a separation between God and man. And that veil had been torn in two. That means that you and I can now go boldly into the throne room of God under the blood of Jesus Christ. He has made a way for you and I. You know, in the Old Testament, they could not enter the Holy of Holies. They could only enter only once a year by the high priest. And for him to do that, he would have to bring blood for his own sins and his family, and then the blood for the people. That was the only time they would enter the Holy of Holies. And even they used to tie a bell around their feet to make sure that God had not killed them. They made a mistake. But now, that veil of separation between God and man had now been torn in two. God says, now my Son has made a way for you to come to me. How? Through his broken body. Through his broken body. You know, that made a way for you and I. You can come boldly and pray to God. You don't have to wait to go to somebody to pray for you. You don't have to ask somebody to pray for you. No, you yourself can enter that throne room. Because Jesus, your forerunner, has gone before you with his blood. He took his own blood and went and placed it at the mercy seat in heaven. Because in the heaven they have a temple as well. Just like Moses built his temple, he has a mercy seat. That's the Holy of Holies. He took his own blood and placed it. By doing that, he made salvation available for everybody who believed in him. As long as his blood is still on the mercy seat, as long as you believe that he died for you, that blood will be used to clear away all your sins. Are you going to do that today? Or are you going to keep on postponing it? Remember that as long as you have breath in you, you can still repent. Mm-hmm. going to die, you cannot repent again. You have to spend eternity in hellfire.
Many people keep on
postponing, and when they land in hell, they keep on regretting that, oh, I had a chance. I didn't take a chance. Remember the robber on the side of Jesus? How he leaped from hell to paradise. At the last minute, he repented. And Jesus told him, today, you will be with me in paradise. He told him, that man was the best example of last minute salvation. He didn't want to wait to that time because you don't know what will be on last minute. That man had a chance, and he took the other thing, did not. And he went to hell. But you still have a chance now because you're still alive watching him today. You can still jump from hell to heaven if only accept that sacrifice. So the power that was released when Jesus' spirit came out of his body, that power caused an earthquake, and see what happened. The graves were opened in Jerusalem, and many bodies of the saints which slept have rose. Came out of the graves after his resurrection and went to the holy city and appeared unto many. So the first that happened was the graves were broken open. This is the first resurrection. This is what was going to happen on the day of judgment. All the graves were opened. And the bodies of the saints will rise up and will come out of the graves on the third day. And they went to the holy city and appeared unto many. Can you imagine seeing your grandfather, somebody I've told you about? You never met him, as you see him. Yeah? Is this grandpa? Are you sure you're grandpa? Many would have run away. I'm sure the whole city was in chaos. And they saw that they were able to come back to talk to them. I said, well, that is the first resurrection. That's what the dead produced. He released all the captives in the graves. So you too will be released today from the captivity of sin, from the graveyard of sin that held you, if you surrender your life to Christ. That same power was released when he died, be released your life. You will break the chain, the prison cell you're on, you'll be released out. Be set free to honor and worship God. The grave of the dead sins, generational sins, all kinds of sins will be released. That same power will be released into your life. Have you not heard testimonies of people who were drunkards,
drug addicts, homosexuals?
Just name it. The day they receive Jesus, what happens? No more lust for prostitution, no more lust for alcohol. No more lust for drugs. Totally changed completely. 100% around. Yes. That's the power of Jesus Christ. To be able to save you the utmost. Those that come to God through him. Doesn't matter what gutter you are in. Jesus is deeper still. Now, when that centurion and those that were with him, the centurion was the one guiding the Jesus on the cross and his fellows, when they saw the earthquake and those things that were done, they feared greatly, saying, truly, this was the Son of God. This is a prayer today that God will manifest his presence in the lives of many. They will truly give the testimony that this is indeed God. Because many will not believe until they see a sign. God showed them a sign that made them to believe that the person they just crucified was the Son of God. And even he heard what felt. And oh my God, what have I done? I didn't know this. God, can you forgive me for crucifying the Son? Because I felt a lot of guilt and condemnation. Seeing what happened, God manifests his glory. So will God manifest his glory in your life today. Those of you who are adapting, once the sin of offense, the creating of the devil. He said, you're not. He will show you a sign that I'm
so strong.
I have no choice but to say, yes, this is the Son of God. Save my soul today. And the women who followed him, Mary Magdalene, Mary mother of James, they were also there. You know, it's a very painful thing to know that Mary was also at the cross to watch her son, her firstborn son, be crucified, knowing that he did nothing to warrant that. And this was a fulfillment of prophecy. Remember that Anna and what was his name? The other man saw him. And he said, a sword will pierce your heart. When they brought Jesus for the name of seven, that was the sword he was referring to. The crucifixion, the death of her firstborn son. A miracle child that was conceived by the Holy Spirit and not by the man.
That
son was crucified and the sword. Yes, they had. Now, before Jesus died, it transpired back here to John. Remember, he said, John, behold your mother. Mary, behold your son. He transpired to that. Taking care of his mother, taking care of. He did not leave her without comfort. It was, we don't know why, Joseph, maybe Joseph had died at this time. But he loved his earthly mother so much. And transferred her to the care of John. So, yeah. What I've just said today, are you ready to surrender your life to Christ? Imagine what it went through because of you. Imagine the pain, the agony, the disgrace. Then think of the power that was released when he died. Don't you want to have that kind of power in your life to break every chain that still has used to hold you? That prison of hopelessness, stagnation, disappointments that you've been going so many years. Have you not had enough of that?
Well, if you have,
you are ready. Say this simple prayer after me. Lord Jesus, sin yes to you. Have mercy upon me today. Wash me with the precious blood. Make me pure and holy before you. Come into my heart today and rule and reign in my life. Be my Lord and Savior. Take my name from the book of the dead and write my name in the book of life. And I will follow you to the end of my days. Thank you for saving my soul. That's it. As you said that prayer, your name has now been written in the book of life and you're on your way to the kingdom of heaven. He will give His Holy Spirit that will walk with you and teach you to be like Him. Let us pray. Jehovah Jesus Christ, be my help. Thank you once again for the precious word supplied. Thank you for the supreme price paid by the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross for us. We thank you that the work of salvation was completed. We thank you that every problem of humanity was solved on the cross. When our Lord Jesus Christ said it was finished. We thank you for that resurrection power was released when the Spirit left his body. Let that power be released to your children today. Let them release them from every grave of sin, every grave of Satan, every grave of witches and wizards. Let them be released today from that bondage that they might come out by your name. Let that reveal to your children today. Let them see that they can truly testify that Jesus is the Son of God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 He's a miracle walking God. He's a miracle walking God. Is the Alpha.